Your hands right now, hallelujah, all across this place in Jesus' name. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you tonight, God. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to read for you tonight, if you would stand in the honor of the reading of God's word. Amen. From 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 25 through 27. Actually, I think I'm going to start at the very first. Yeah, we're going to start with the first verse there for just a moment. I want to back up and give you just a little bit tonight from this wonderful word of God. 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 1 through 3. The Bible says, "And it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, See now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, Go and do all that is in your heart, for the Lord is with thee. Skipping down to verse 25 through 27. David says, And now, O Lord God, the word that thou hast spoken concerning thy servant and concerning his house, establish it forever and do as thou hast said. And let thy name be magnified forever, saying, The Lord of hosts is the God over Israel, and let the house of thy servant David be established before thee. For thou, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, hast revealed to thy servant, saying, I will build thee an house. Therefore hath thy servant found in his heart to pray this prayer unto thee. Turning over really quickly, if you can, if you have your Bible with me, to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 11 through 16. Amen. I'll give you a moment to get there as I get there as well. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 11 through 16. I just read to you from 2 Samuel 7 and 25 through 27 about David's dream. David's vision was to build a house for the Lord, to do kingdom work. We kind of skipped over my title, but I'll give it to you in just a moment again. But I want to read now in this second passage of scripture from 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 11 through 16. David's dream became Solomon's reality. The Bible says, Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord, and the king's house, and all that came into Solomon's heart to make in the house of the Lord and in his own house, he prosperously effected. And the Lord appeared unto Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open, and my ears attent to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever. And mine eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually. As for thee, verse 17, I don't think I put that up there. I didn't. I stopped at 16. We'll stop at 16. But I want to just quickly remind you from the very first passage in the Bible that we read. And I'm sorry, my computer is not cooperating with me. It wants to close out on me quicker than I can get to it. But in chapter 7 and verse 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 1, the Bible says that it came to pass when the king sat in his house. This is David. And the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies. And then the Lord told him, after he gave him rest from his enemies, go and do what is in your heart. I'm going to preach for just a little bit tonight. I hope I'm not too long. in your hearing about kingdom battles. And my subtitle is, If My People Pray. If my people pray, you will fight kingdom battles in Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, thank you for your word right now. Thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost we feel in this house. We're asking you, Lord, for a mighty move of your spirit tonight in this place. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen. You may be seated. There is a difference tonight in kingdom enemies and your enemies. I want us to understand clearly tonight that we fight personal battles. We go through struggles in life. And we say to God, Lord, I just want to do something for you. Why is it so hard? Why am I struggling? And why is it so difficult for me just to do what I want to do for you? David was no exception to this rule or to this circumstance. David was anointed back in 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 13. The Bible says that he was anointed in the midst of his brethren. And God intended to make David the king, but there were several important battles that David was going to have to fight before he could ever become king. David was going to have to fight some personal battles, some personal enemies, before he could ever be a kingdom battler, before he could ever battle in the kingdom and for the kingdom of God. And let me tell you tonight, once the enemy discovers that you are anointed by God, that you have a purpose and you have a plan, and God plans to use you mightily, deaf or hearing, it doesn't matter. The enemy comes to attack you. He doesn't come to attack the kingdom of God. He comes to attack you personally. Because the devil knows that if we get tied up in our personal battles, if we get tied up in the struggles that we fight day to day, he doesn't have to worry about you fighting a kingdom battle. He doesn't have to worry about what you're going to do for God's kingdom, because you're tied up with your day in and your day out. You can't go and win souls. You can't reach out to the deaf community. You can't do what God's called you to do, because you're struggling day in and day out with the same old problem. You cannot successfully fight kingdom battles tonight, listen to what I'm saying, until you triumph over your personal struggles. If you are constantly struggling tonight, you will never be effective in the kingdom fight. But if my people pray. Where's my brother with the prayer shawl? Brother, I think his name is Kevin. I can't remember. The tall, big boy. He's right there. I want you to come up. Bring your shawl. Come here. He told Pastor Rowan tonight. He said, I felt the Lord tell me that I needed to put this on tonight. This is a prayer shawl. This is what the priest put on before he entered into the Holy of Holies. He knew the importance of being covered by the Spirit of God before he went in to do kingdom work. The priest wasn't going to go into that tabernacle without the covering on him. The priest was going to go in, and he had taken care of his business before he went in. Because if he knew that if he entered into the Holy of Holies without the covering and the proper covering of prayer in his life, he would not come out alive. He would die inside there, and they would pull him by his leg on a rope out of the Holy of Holies. We're talking about kingdom battles, amen, in this day and age that we're in. We have to fight kingdom battles. We've got to win souls. We've got to set up deaf churches. We got to set up deaf ministry in every state across the United States that doesn't have a deaf ministry. But I'm going to tell you tonight that the enemy wants you to listen to the voices of the world. The enemy wants you to listen to other things besides God's voice. But if my people pray, God will bring the deliverance. The Bible tells us that in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 28, the Bible says that David went to the battle. David went out down to where the battle was going to take place. And as soon as he got there, he was met with opposition. He was met with the voice of accusation. He was anointed to be king, yes, but he was not king yet. And God knew that when David went to the battlefield that day, that the voice of accusation was going to be railed against him. Let me tell you today that Goliath is not the enemy of David personally. Goliath was a kingdom battle. He was the enemy of the people of God. He was the enemy of the kingdom of God. And David's real enemy that day when he walked out to the battlefield was really the voice of those around him telling him that you can't do the will of God. Remember what I told you in the very beginning of this service tonight, or me preaching tonight, that you were in the middle of the will of God. I'm going to tell you that over and over until it gets inside of your heart and inside of your mind. And it's something that you can't separate from tonight, because the enemy is the accuser of the brethren. And he wants you to fail. He wants you to be weak. He wants you to not succeed in the kingdom battle tonight. But I'm going to tell you tonight that if my people pray, come on, I need somebody to understand what I'm saying. If my people pray, God is going to bring the victory. What is our weapon against Satan's accusation? What is it, the things that he's saying are true? It's okay, David, you can still fight the battle. You can still go, because David told his brother that day. He said, is there not a cause? And I ask you today, is there not a cause in your family? Is there not a cause in your community? Is there not a cause in your state? Is there not a cause in the deaf community tonight? Amen. For you to walk out to that battlefield and tell that giant, I come not to you with sword and spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We've got to come in the name of the Lord. But we've got to do it when we pray. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's not the end of David's story. David faced other battles in his life. The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 25 and verse 10 that David was on his way, and he had his army with him, and he came across a very strong man in the community, Nabal, and his wife Abigail. The Bible says that he sent his men forward so that they could go and they could negotiate with this great man, and they could find a way to not come to conflict with him, no battle with him. And David sent his men out, and they went out and told him, Nabal, we were good to your servants. We didn't steal any of your cattle. We didn't do anything bad or harm your people. So we want you to be friends with us. We want you to do, oh God, come into some contract with us so that we can remain or pass through unharmed. I'm going to tell you today that this voice of insecurity, amen, that David heard from Nabal that day, because Nabal told David, if you read in verse 25, he said, who is this David? The enemy is going to look at you and say, who are you, Brother Swanson? Who are you, Brother Nolan? Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are going all over the world, going to foreign missions, going to North American missions works, setting up deafness? Who do you think you are? The enemy's voice of accusation, the enemy's voice of insecurity is going to be talking in your ear. But we got to know who we are. And the only way we know who we are is if my people pray. What is our identity? We are apostolics in every way that song said. We are apostolics in every way. If we really believe that we are apostolic, we will get into an upper room experience no matter where we're at, no matter what day it is, no matter what time it is, and we'll believe God for the moving of His Spirit. The enemy wants you to think like Israel thought, that we are just grasshoppers in their sight. The enemy wants you to think so small of yourself that you will feel insecure. I'm talking about personal battles that you have to fight before you can do kingdom battles. The third thing that David faced in his life, the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 8, amen, verse 6, amen, let me read it for you here, starting in verse 6, but the thing displeased Samuel the prophet, when they said, Israel said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord, and he said, this will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, and to be his horsemen. And some run before his chariots. Verse 12, and he will appoint him captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear to ground and to reap his harvest and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. And he will make your daughters to be confectionaries and be cooks and to be bakers. You could go on to the next verse. The next slide, there we go. And he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. And he will take the tenth of your seed and the vineyards, and he'll give to his officers and to his servants. And he will make or take your men servants and your maid servants and your goodliest men and your asses, and he put them to work, his work. And he will take the tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants. And ye shall cry out in that day because of your king, which ye shall have chosen you. And the Lord will not hear you in that day. That we also may be like, they said in verse 20, all the other nations, that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. Fight our battles. Saul was made king instead of the Lord ruling over the nation. I'm going to tell you today, you need to be careful when what you want is not pleasing to the man of God in your life. God may give it to you, and you will suffer things in your life that you weren't intended to suffer. You will suffer the consequences of a carnal king in your life instead of the King of Kings being in control. David faced, Saul faced, the people of Israel faced carnality. The people rejected the Lord because they wanted to be like other nations. And this was not a rejection of the preacher, the prophet Samuel, but it was a rejection of God. Saul was never God's anointed, kingdom-minded leader. He always did what he wanted to do. All the things that he said that he would do, he did. And God let them fall away. Amen. Ever since leaving Egypt, they became slaves again to Saul and his will. They wanted something else to fight their battles. They wanted somebody else to fight their kingdom battles. Today, our problem in the United Pentecostal Church, and I dare say in most churches around the world today, is that people want somebody else to do their praying for them. They want the man of God to do the praying for them. They want the assistant pastor to do the praying for them. Oh, pastor, please pray for me. I'm struggling with this thing again. And you come down to the altar time and time and time again, and these good men come up and they anoint you with oil and they try to do their best to help you overcome that battle. But I'm going to tell you today, the only way you're going to fight that battle is if my people pray. Come on, we've got to learn how again to get back to the fundamental apostolic doctrine of prayer. What started this church, amen, on the day of Pentecost is going to take this church into glory. What started this church in North America in 1906 or whatever the year was in Azusa Street was people getting together in a room and they decided, God, I'm not going anywhere until you bless me. God, I'm not doing anything else until you answer my prayer. I'm going to get down in this old-fashioned Pentecostal altar and I'm going to learn how to get a hold of you again. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Saul wanted David to wear his armor. Saul wanted David to go out to face Goliath, the kingdom battle, wearing his armor. He wanted to bring attention to himself. He wanted to bring the glory to himself. His insignia was stamped on the front of the breastplate. He wanted no one to know that it wasn't him. He wanted David to be covered in his armor so that he could get the glory. But I'm telling you today, when we pray, we bring glory and honor to the Lord, and he will fight our battles. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, I'm talking about kingdom battles that we've got to win. But before we can win kingdom battles, we have to fight against the voice of accusation that says that you're not good enough. You're never going to be the king, the right kind of king, David. You're going to be just, you're just here and you're going out to face the giant because you want everybody to look at you. The accuser is going to be coming against you. Amen. And the voice of insecurity is going to say, who are you? What do you think you're doing here? What do you think you're doing in the ministry? What do you think you're doing witnessing to somebody? Teaching a Bible study? What do you think you're doing? Amen. But I'm going to tell you today, amen, you have to fight those battles through prayer. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, in the New Testament, Romans chapter 8, the Bible says, amen, that to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. One of the battles that David had to face, one of the battles that he had to overcome before he could become king and fight a kingdom battle, was his old flesh. David had to be somewhere on the backside of the 40 somewhere, taking care of his father's sheep. And he had to endure the shame of being the son that was forgotten, not even brought in for the anointing, not even brought before the prophet, not even brought there, even thought of. He wasn't even a second thought. He was way down the line. David knew that he was going to have to overcome some things. And before David could become the man after God's own heart, David had to learn how to pray. Hallelujah. The Bible says that to be carnally minded, amen, is death. Death. Separation from God. The Bible, the dictionary says that carnality means pertaining to or characterized by the flesh or the body. Its passions or appetites, its carnal pleasures, not spiritual, merely human, temporal, worldly, a man thinking about the world rather than spiritual things. All right. Carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. If you want to live a life that is full, amen, and has peace, and overcomes, the Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. But I'm going to tell you today, you won't ever overcome in the flesh. Amen. If you don't pray, if we don't get down in our personal life, in our prayer closet or our prayer altar at home or wherever you have it set up, and if you don't have it set up and this is the only place you pray, shame on you. Shame on me. We've got to learn how to get back and win our victories through prayer. Prayer will change the battlefield. Prayer will change what we face and how we face the enemy. The Bible says in Acts chapter 4 and verse 31, the Bible says, when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spake the word of God with boldness. I just saw Brother Swanson during this worship time at the end. He said that he went out or he saw someone, I think it was a police officer that he saw. He said, why not invite him? Why not be bold? Go ahead and ask him to come on in. Because you know what? We have to do this with prayer and being full of the Holy Ghost. Because there's power in prayer. There's power in prayer. Verse 32 of Acts chapter 4 says, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them aught of the things that he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power gave the apostles witness the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. Neither was there any among them that lacked. Come on, I'm talking about battles, spiritual battles, kingdom battles. If you're tired of struggling, if you're tired of lacking, if you're tired of always being behind, if you're tired of always feeling like I'm never going to get ahead, the Bible says in Acts chapter 4, verse 35, that when they prayed, none of them lacked. For as many as were possessors of land and houses, and they bought things, the prices of things that were sold, they laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made, every man according to his need, or as he had need. If when they prayed, if nothing happened, if there were no changes, they would never have prayed again. If nothing happened when you prayed, you would never come back to church again. You would never understand why the New Testament church talked about prayer so much. But something did happen when they prayed. If we want signs and wonders and miracles, and I believe that we do, we must pray. If there was ever a need that we have in modern day apostolic church, we need to pray. If we want to win kingdom battles, we have to get back to apostolic prayer. Don't get me wrong, I love the music. I love the worship time. But there's no substitute for prayer. I love programs. I love what we do to bring people in. But there's no substitute for prayer. I love conferences. I love youth conferences and conventions and youth camps and youth rallies. But there is no substitute for old-fashioned prayer in the last day. Without prayer, there is no Spirit of God. Not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, I'm trying to reach for somebody. I'm trying to get somebody to understand what I'm saying tonight. That if my people pray, something's going to change. Look at old Peter on the day of Pentecost, standing up with the 11, preaching the word of God, delivering the plan of salvation. But just a few days before, a woman confronted him in Pilate's court and said, you're one of them. And of course, you know the story. Peter denied and said, no, that wasn't me. In fact, he did it three times and even cursed against even knowing Jesus. But oh, what a difference an old-fashioned prayer meeting made in that upper room. Because when Peter stood up with the 11 on that day, he was bold and he preached the word of God to those people that were there to hear. And they were pricked in their hearts and they said, "What shall we do?" You know the story. You know how it was that day. When that lady saw him the day before the cross, Peter was hiding, and he was scared, and he was ashamed, and he was defeated. He hadn't overcome his personal battles. But look what prayer did for Peter. He stood up with the 11 on that day, and he said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." When they prayed, they spoke with boldness. When they prayed, things changed. People that don't pray don't have holy boldness. People that don't pray, come on. You can go ahead and give me your good old Baptist nod. That's all right. Go ahead. Come on. Have you ever felt impressed to speak to somebody by the Lord, and then you quench that spirit thinking, "Oh, that's just me. Oh, that's just me." Well, let me tell you something. That is just you. But when you pray, you have the word of God in your mouth, and you speak the word of God because you have prayed. Something has to get a hold of us in this hour that says, "Here I am, Lord. Send me. Speak through me. Give me the words to speak, God. Don't let me be just the one standing by the side, the wayside, but speak the word through me with boldness." About a year ago, a little over a year ago, the Lord called me to go to a different state. I've been in the state of Texas from the time that I was 7 years old. For 41 years, I stayed there, and I felt like that was where I needed to be to raise my family and to do what the Lord had called me to do. And it wasn't long after my parents had both passed away that I felt an upheaval in my spirit, and I felt an uprooting in me, and I began to talk to the Lord. I began to really pray. I began to really seek His face. The Lord started dealing with me about moving to go to Pennsylvania. And I thought, "Lord, what am I going to do when I get there? How am I going to survive? I've got a good job here. I've got a home here. My roots are down here. My family is here. My kids live not too far away. And what am I going to do for a job if I go there? And how is this all going to work out? Lord, I don't know that I can do this. I don't think that I have the might or the power of my own self to make this decision to go forward." And the Lord just told me, and He urged me, "Just go and just get there. Just get there. Get to that place." So I made the move. And I got there, and I got together with a man of God that I'd known for a while. We had ministered together and worked together in Texas for a while in our home church under Brother Macy. And I told him, I said, "You know, I think I'm supposed to come here and be here full time. What do you think?" And he said, "Brother Mark, we've got to pray about it. We've got to pray about it." So we weren't going to take this situation lightly. We weren't going to fight this battle lightly. So we began to pray, and I went back home, and I talked to my pastor, Brother Macy. And I'll tell you, the thing that shocked me the most was Pastor Macy told me, he said, "Brother Mark, I've been waiting for you and the Lord to get on the same page. I've been waiting for you to submit yourself to God and do what God had asked you to do. And I've just been waiting for you to follow His voice." You know, the Bible tells us that the prophet in the Old Testament was commanded to go and wait down by the brook. The Bible tells us that the Lord told him to go there and wait. "Go there and I'm going to feed you. I'm going to send the raven. I'm going to send provision for you. You go there and wait. And you go there and just be where I told you to be." I'm convinced, Brother Rowan, that if we don't get where God is telling us to get in an apostolic mind frame of prayer, that we're never going to get the provision that God wants to give us for revival and deaf ministry. We've got to be in one mind. We've got to have one heart. We have to have one soul. You guys know what I'm talking about? This is the same that they had on the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. Amen. This is what happened. This is what brought about Pentecost. And when the day of Pentecost
was fully come. They were with one mind, one accord, in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it appeared as a cloven tongues, like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. What were they doing in the upper room? Why were they there in that day on Jerusalem? Because they were obeying the Lord when he said, go and tarry until I send the promise. They weren't just sitting around twiddling their thumbs on the day of Pentecost. They were in a red hot prayer meeting in the upper room. And when they prayed, the Spirit of God fell. Amen. My arm has never told me I can't do that. I don't want you to feed me. I don't want you to bless me. The Bible says they were in one mind and one accord. They weren't this person's idea, that person's idea. They were in a prayer meeting together, and they were worshiping God, and they were waiting for the promise of God. If all of the body isn't working together in prayer, the work of the kingdom will not be done. I know this is a hard saying. I know what I'm saying to you tonight is difficult to hear. But when they prayed, they had a greater understanding of stewardship. They supported the church. They built the church together. The more you pray, the more you want to do in the church. The more you pray, the more you want to give. The more you give, God's going to give you more blessings. Amen. There was an old song that said, I want to live the way you want me to live. I want to give until there's just no more to give. I want to love till there's just no more love. I could never outlove the Lord. I did that song before the sermon tonight more than anything. Lord, I love you more than anything. But I'm afraid to tell you today that the problem with us in our hearts and our lives is that we put false gods in front of the Lord God. We put things in our life that become the king in our life. We ask for a king. We ask for our own way. We ask for our own ideas. And God is saying, you'll want that for a time, and I'll let you have it. But if you really want to be effective in the kingdom of God, you've got to pray. When they prayed, the Bible says, great grace was upon them. They cared for one another when they prayed. Come on, I'm talking about the church. This is the ecclesiastical conference. This is the conference of the church. When they prayed, they loved each other. They were more sensitive to each other's needs when they prayed. You're not alone in this. We are the body of Christ, and we need each other. I need you. You need me. Somebody prayed for me. I'm praying for you. I prayed for this conference. We need to get back to great grace. Jesus said that he came not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Why do we think we are qualified to do so? People, we have to have great grace. The church is my only army that I can depend on. But I'm afraid that sometimes the church is the only army I've ever seen that will shoot its wounded. Somebody fails and we look down on them. Somebody falls away and we think, oh, well, I'm glad I'm not like that guy. I'm glad I'm not in his position. I'm going to tell you today, we need to pray. We need to pray for great grace. Hallelujah. When they prayed, the Bible says the place was shaken. Paul and Silas, Acts chapter 16 and verse 25, sitting in the inner prison, bound hand and foot, chained and condemned and beaten, and in the darkest hour that they could be in, the Bible says they began to sing. No, it doesn't say they began to sing. It says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. The first thing that they did wasn't strike up the band and let's have some music and let's run and dance and shout. They were bound in the darkest place of the inner prison, but they knew how to pray. If you want some things in your life to be shaken so that the prison doors swing wide open, you need to find an apostolic altar of prayer. Peter and John, in Acts chapter 3 and verse 1, Peter and John went together to the temple at the hour of prayer. Come on, I'm talking about what the apostles did. You and I still gotta do. We can't abandon this apostolic doctrine of prayer. The only thing in Scripture that has ever come up before God as a memorial, Acts chapter 10 and verse 4, was a man's prayer. Cornelius, what are you doing on the rooftop? I'm praying. But you're not even a Jew. But you're not even a part of this kingdom yet. But I'm praying. The only thing that ever came up to God and God noticed as memorial was that man's prayer. You want God to pay attention to you? You want God to look at your things and become interested? You need to get interested in the things of God. When we pray, we have power. And with great power, the Bible says, the apostles gave witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. You want to see some dead things in your life come to life again? It'll happen when we pray. Stand with me for a minute. The Bible says, and ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. You will receive power to be witnesses unto me. We can't wait any longer for end time revival. We must pray. We can't wait any longer for somebody else to be in a prayer meeting for us. We must pray. Going back to 2 Chronicles and reading again for you to hear. He said in verse 14, if my people which are called by my name, are you called by his name today? Do you have his name in your heart? Have you been baptized in the name of Jesus? If you will humble yourself and pray and seek his face and turn from your wicked way, there are promises that he said he would give. Then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive your sin, and I will heal your land. If my people pray. I'm opening up this altar right now, because I'm telling you right now tonight that the only way some things are going to break in your life and in your circumstance and your situation is if you'll find a place to pray right here tonight. I know I'm not the only one that has experienced this in my life. I know I'm not alone in this situation. I've been in that situation so many times. I'm so frustrated in my life so many times. God, why am I fighting this same battle over and over and over again? And God always leads me back to a time of prayer. Son, you've got to pray and you've got to depend on me. You've got to depend on me. Not long after I moved to Erie, Pennsylvania, we baptized a young man by the name of Jesus Castilla in Jesus' name. We were all excited because Jesus was coming out of the Catholic Church and he was understanding the truth. He had been given a Bible study. Pastor had been teaching him. And he was coming in and we got the chance to take him outside in a hot tub and it was cold out still. But we went ahead and we baptized him in Jesus' name. 3 weeks, 4 weeks later, I think it was less than a month later, we heard through the tragic circumstances of the news that Jesus Castillo had passed away in his home. A young man of about 25 years old, 26 years old, and he had just been baptized in Jesus' name, hadn't even fully understood all of the truth yet. But he had his chance to come every week, but he didn't come. We don't know, and we're not going to stand in judgment today of what's happened to Jesus, whether he's here or there in heaven or hell. I'm not going to be the judge today. But I'm going to tell you that if God gives you the opportunity to find an altar to pray, you better not pass it up, because you don't know when the time is short and when your time is going to be. God might call you home tonight after this service, and God forbid that that would happen to anybody in this place. But I'm telling you tonight, we've got to find an apostolic altar of prayer, because we have to overcome our battles if we're going to fight kingdom battles. You want to win souls. You want to do something for God. You want to do the great things. But you got to do the things that overcome your personal battles first. You've got to find a place to pray. Hallelujah. Oh, I love you, Lord, tonight. Lord, I love you more than anything tonight. Come on, let it be your prayer tonight. This altar is open. I'm not calling anybody. I'm not going to beg anybody. But I believe the Spirit of the Lord is calling those of you in this house tonight to come, amen, and give yourself in prayer to him tonight.